So the lecture today is about alignment and translation. The objective, the learning objective today are primarily one about multimodal alignment. I want to expand. We talked about the dynamic time warping. We also studied the attention-based mechanism. But I also want to give you a few more, also specifically for speech and speech recognition. There are a few approaches. There's one specific one on CTC that I want to discuss. And then I also, from alignment, look at one more specifically for video, although I think it can be generalized eventually to multimodal, is on temporal cycle consistency. So these are somewhat a little bit more unimodal, but again, with the idea to expand to alignment to multimodal. And then I want to look at the translation, and specifically I would like to study visual question answering. I'm picking it specifically because image captioning is great, and I think has brought a multimodal together in a very nice way. But visual question answering address one of the key challenges on the evaluation side. And so a lot of interesting work came following that. So I'm going to use visual question answering to introduce a lot of the other work that I want to talk about, like co-attention, stack attention, and also neural module networks are a very interesting way to bring domain knowledge and expertise in those neural architectures. And some people went a step further and took neural module network and extended it to make it even more interpretable. And what the neural symbolic learning is doing. And finally, I wanted to show some applications. I think sometimes it's interesting to see that, specifically because speech and video translation is quite an interesting topic. So that's the lecture today, a little bit more about speech and vision, because we studied language quite a bit, but also studying the translation. So alignment, I would like to talk about alignment specifically for a second for speech recognition. I know we studied, as I just mentioned, language and vision quite a bit. When we look at speech recognition is a multimodal task, at least in the way we approach it in this lecture and this class, in this course. And it goes from an acoustic signal, a speech signal, all the way to language. And it's really interesting because we go from it's a translation, and we're translating from acoustic all the way to language. But the issue here is that we are going from something that's very high granularity, like very fine grain, like the audio signal, to something that is, you could almost call discrete, like the language. And so it's a very interesting translation process because of its importance also for many applications and how humans are communicating through speech. It has been an interest for a very long time in AI. And so there has been very well established pipelines. I'm going to just give one of these inspired with some earlier tutorial is like, how do you go from something that's very raw audio, if you remember, is just a 1D vector, and you go all the way to words. And to go there as a first step is the challenge of how do you represent the audio, how do you represent that? And if you think and remember one of the earlier lecture, how do you represent audio as a first stage, like going beyond just a vector, raw vector? Spectrogram was one of these approaches where you look at the frequency. So taking a sliding window of audio, like a, let's say maybe 10 milliseconds of audio, and looking at the frequency during that 10 millisecond, how much 20,000 hertz, how much, and that's what you would do like with something like a fast Fourier transform, for example. And then a spectrogram does it over time. So you have both time and a frequency there. So this has been studied a lot. And as I mentioned, there's been extension to that. I also start to look at how the ear is doing this and start looking at it, not just as every frequency exactly the same, but you look at some bank of frequencies are like filter bank, and the MEL frequency, the MFCC features are one example to that. When it gets closer to, at that point, I think we're still very like speech oriented, where like the magic in a sense that goes from speech to language is a lot in those next two steps. The first one is to start classifying the frames. And so it uses often the word frames because it's a local acoustic observation, we'll call it a frame. And so we want to classify them, and classifying, you could classify, is it a word, which word is it? But they, a lot of the work in both speech and linguistic have studied like the phonology. And so we start looking at that point, looking at phonemes and detecting what each of these local in time, how each of them sound, and the sound is a phoneme. And so you get finally an output, and the different colors here are the different colors, the different phonemes, and each language, spoken language, will often have a very concrete set of phonemes. And then from these phonemes, which will be, let's say for this, we'll call them Q, we'll want to get from the set of phoneme, we want, from these initial set of H frame connected, you want to get to the, what are the continuous, contiguous phonemes. So one here is a prediction at every frame, but eventually you want to make a final decision that this is the same phoneme. And eventually you will want to go from all of those phonemes to words. And that's usually through a lexicon model. And I'm not going to discuss it as much today, but this is, and then the language model we discussed quite a bit. But this is like a specify what are words made, what are the phonemes that made of word, and here you're like, what are the words that are close to each other, what are the, because W is a vector, so what are the words that are likely to be next to each other. And if you remember, when we look at word to vec, we looked at these we look at like either predicting the next word, or we'll like fill the blank kind of scenarios, like in BERT. So all of these comes in together. And so when we discuss and we want to predict the most likely words, this could be a very interesting but very complex pipeline. And some of them are deterministic, as I mentioned. So there's been a lot of work on feature extraction and lexicon, but the middle part is where there's a lot of interesting work on alignment, on sequence labeling, which is the first step, but also aligning them to the phonemes. That's a problem. And so if I talk to you about sequence labeling and alignment, how can we solve this task? My input is a spectrogram, my output is a phoneme. I know that many samples will map to the same phoneme, so it's a many to one kind of mapping. So how can I solve, how can I predict this set of phoneme? And I just want the phoneme, is possible, like I would like to know that all of these together are the same T, and all of these together, although this exact for the spectrogram may not be the match with this, but like tomato, pronounced maybe a little bit of a French way. So a first way to do it will be a sequence to sequence model. It's like a very like 101 machine translation, going from one language to another language. I embed my first modality, in this case, speech. I get my intermediate representation, and then I have a generative model that will simply go ahead and generate these different phonemes one after another, all conditioned on that initial seed that came from the embedding on that. And this will be done, as I showed here, as a recurrent neural network, or as we know also, these could be maybe a self-attention models like a transformer, as we discussed. Talking of transformer, we could also make it as an attention base. So in the case of an RNN, we can bring the attention. And so instead of embedding my spectrogram only once and making it such that there's only one time that I encode the spectrogram and then use that to create the series of phonemes, I could go at every new time I want to get a new phoneme and decide where to focus on. And these are one way, but what if I wanted to just do sequence labeling with an RNN right away? One way will be to get the label at each audio, but then I will miss that extra step, which is this like many to one alignment. And so I wanted to share an approach and a loss function, and specifically an approach to how do you handle that many to one alignment. And this was, that got very popular in speech recognition. It gave a really strong performance. And that's a little bit why I want to bring this. Also, because it may give you some intuitions on how to extend that kind of work. But CTC, which is it's a term that was brought by the authors of this paper of connectionist temporal classification. It's kind of quite a long name, but let's just call it CTC for now. And this is has been up to now. And I will say now we see approaches that don't use it, but up to now it was used with a lot of these deep neural network architecture for automatic speech recognition. And these, a lot of them were either simple convolution, a few layer like deep speech, which is still state of the art up to maybe a few years ago, but yeah, but it was quite strong. And so it was a convolution, it was a bidirectional and then fully connected. But the key aspect was how do you do that many to one mapping, that alignment? Because I have on one sense, very high frame rate, very different granularity between my modalities, very different granularity. And how do I handle that? And so to formalize this mathematically, the X will be at a frame rate, maybe at, let's say 20 Hertz, I compute my spectrogram. But the phonemes, like if you say that maybe you speak 3 or 4 words per second, each phonemes, maybe like more about 10 to 12 phonemes per second. And the goal is to take, and you may even have higher for the number of frames for this. And so you want to do that many to one mapping that I just discussed. And so you don't have the same length and you want to define over the space of label, the space of label here will be the phonemes. And so we want to do two things at the same time, both doing the many to one mapping and at the same time train our whole model or classifier as they call it in the CTC. So the loss will be more of a typical loss, the negative log likelihood, and that's defined over the probability or the score over the phoneme. But the question is how the rest of the model works and how can we do that many to one mapping. And so to explain this, I'm going to go through all the steps that a CTC implements. Before CTC, I had already done some scoring. And so it will maybe with an RNN or in the case of deep speech, we saw all of the layers. And so, but let's suppose I have them and then I will just do our typical normalization. And so from those normalized output, I get this nice distribution. And this distribution is over all possible phoneme. So here I draw them as if there were only 5 of them, but if you remember, there may be 50 or 20 of them. I'm just showing 5 of them. And so for each of those 50 or 100 of these, I will want to predict which phoneme can I currently hear. And so I can just plot all of these different phonemes. So if my language like English has a certain number of phonemes, that would be the number L, the number of phoneme. and T is over time. And then I will do this extra one, which is for blank or no label, maybe a silence or just something else that I don't have a label for it. And so the idea here, which has a flavor, we'll discuss a little bit more when we talk about graphical models, but the idea of looking at the path over this activation, because what this is I have almost a probability because it has been normalized. And so I have a probability over all of these labels. And now I want to know what has been spoken. What did the person really speak? And it's possible that I'm more than once on the same phoneme. And maybe there's a pause and then there's another phoneme. And so I want to be able to like T and there's a pause and then ah. And so I want to know what is this optimal set of phonemes. And so I can have a very large set of paths. In fact, there's, if you look at it, there's every possible path that I could imagine. It's not infinite, but there's a large number. Luckily, it looks a lot like things like optimizing an HMM, which hidden Markov model, which we'll discuss more in details next lecture. But this, you can compute relatively easily probability of a specific path. I have one path in this. What is the probability of that path to be? And so this is the probability over the path that you can, given the input X. And now I'm still not yet decided completely because I have a probability of one path. And then I want to predict the labels. The labels will then be a chain rule of then the probability, the temporal alignment, I'm going to talk about it in a second, time each of the probability. So I have the probability of a path, and then that path, I need to go from a path to very, very specific set of phonemes. And that's really interesting because in this case, you could have maybe tried to learn it. And I want to say that's probably the approach that we, the, in the neural network world, we always think, hey, I need to learn everything. Everything has to be learned from scratch. But there may be knowledge we already have that we can add to the model. And so some components of the model may not need to be learned or relearned again. And that's a little bit the approach they use here. They said, let's remove all the blanks. Let's repeat all the labels. And that's a very simple set of rules. And then once you have this, and then you can do an optimization to try the most probable sequence labels. And then, so how do you optimize this? Because you have all possible sets of paths. There's two ways to optimize, or at least there's more than two, but there's two ways originally proposed. And then one is just to take whichever is the most optimal path here. And then from that most optimal path, just use my rules, my handwritten rules, and then get whichever the optimal phonemes are. The more classic way, if anybody who's done HMM, will be to use dynamic programming and then do a forward backward algorithm. It's a really well established algorithm to, if you have in the HMM hidden Markov model and you have all of these states and you have also probabilities over those states and you want to know what is the most likely sequence of states, that will be a forward backward algorithm for that. The extension to that will be belief propagation, which is a generalization of the forward backward algorithm. And it works with a forward set, you kind of pass the messages, and that's what you accumulate through those alpha, and then you pass them again, you accumulate to the beta, and then you multiply, you get that, you integrate them together. I want to show one thing interesting with CTC. I know this graph is a lot of information. So you have the raw waveform. And what I show here is a typical output of before CTC. Like what will be the typical output, which is also what kind of is the input to CTC in a sense, is like predicting at every point in time, trying to predict the phoneme and simply like working from it and getting to, for every speech frame, predicting the phoneme with maybe some smoothness to be sure that things are close to each other, are similar labels. One of the challenges when you predict that at the frame line is that even though you maybe have predicted correctly the phoneme, if you make any error a little bit, let's say before, and you got it a little bit wrong before or after, that will get penalized. The model will get penalized for those misalignment in the boundary. So the idea here is that you don't want the CTC, if you see the big difference in the predictions, is a lot more peaky. And you have to ask yourself, why is it so peaky? Because CTC focuses on the phoneme transitions. And so it's looking at the transition. And if you're looking at the pipeline for speech recognition, in that case, I don't really care that the phoneme was spoken for a very long time, like hello or hello. I mean, they're both the same word, hello. And so, as long as I know which phonemes happened, then I can use that information. And I think this is the key, and the part I like the most about CTC is that it focuses on transitions and looking at, and for the task of speech recognition, this was sufficient. And so when you look at alignment and you look at these temporal tasks, you have to ask yourself, do I really need to know exactly the boundary of everything? Or will it be sufficient to only focus on the transitions? And CTC is one of these approaches, and there's been a lot of extension to that since then. But and there's been a little bit of work also before on transition, but I wanted to make you aware of these other approaches. I want to also I'd like to talk about not just speech, but also video alignment. And we discussed it with dynamic time warping as an example for that, where you're trying to align two videos. It could be from different modalities, or it could be just two videos that, you know, like two people doing the same action. You don't know exactly when, they may be not aligned perfectly, and the action may be done differently, like maybe a different version of this, but you want to align it. And so we talk about dynamic time warping that solved this through dynamic programming. And that was one approach. This is great. And I know that some students had asked, like, is there a differentiable version of it? And we added it as a reading assignment. It's an interesting extension of the dynamic time warping. But I also wanted to go a step further and look at like what are the how to take advantage of neural representation. Like we discussed in the first like 3 weeks ago about how you can learn neural representation. What I mean by learning neural representation is we have a frame and we can encode a frame in such a way. And this is the value of the encoding. And in this case, the encoding is only one dimensional. In a normal encoding, the dimension will be a multidimensional, like a CNN, maybe 700 or more, or 3000 of these dimensions. And so I want a way to embed, I want to take advantage of these neural representation. And I want to take advantage of it in such a way that when I learn this, I will also be able to emphasize and also solve for the alignment problem. So I would like at the same time that I'm learning the way to encode images, I would like to also at the same time learn to align between images and between videos. It could be a set, and in this case, we'll talk about videos, like two videos. And there's a big premise, because a lot of people would call it self-supervised learning, and that's how the authors also call it. But you have a big premise that you have paired data and video sequences where there is paired data. Paired in the sense that you know that there's some of the same actions that are happening in that, and that alignment will be possible at some level. Although there's extension, you could imagine, where you look at outlier rejection where there is, in fact, where you could make that premise loosen up a little bit. But for now, we'll say we know that these videos are possible to align, but we don't know how to align. And through that process, we want to learn to embed the videos in such a way that we get an embedding that is telling us about better what the actions are, and like a better embedding. So we both at the same time want to get better embedding and better alignment at the same time. And so how can we do, and what would be a loss function? What should be an interesting loss function to encode this? And the loss function for that is one that I thought was really intuitive and really interesting. Well, intuitive once you get it, but it's one of these things. I mean, ideas sound so simple once you've heard about it, but it's really great. And I like the intuition behind this idea. It's like temporal cycle consistency. That's the name the authors gave to this approach. And the basic idea is my closest neighbor should also have me as their closest neighbor. You want them to be as this. So a cycle consistency will be if I believe and I look I'm one frame of sequence B, let's say, and so I look at all of the frames in sequence A, or let's say video two, and then I look at one frame, the other frame for video one, and I look which one looks the most like me. Which one looks the most like me? And I will suppose for now, let's say that it's not optimized that way, but let's say it was optimized iteratively. Let's say I have already an embedding for both of them. And so I could imagine look like, hey, my embedding and look at those, and you could do something as simple as a cosine similarity. And so you look at, hey, which of these are the closest to me? And so here would be a 1D TSNE that will be shown here maybe. And so, and then I go and look at all of the, for that closest one to me, I look at, hey, what frame is the closest to you? Like from your perspective, look at all of the other frame and look at which one is the closest to you. And if it's not a match, I'm going to penalize it. And so I want as much as possible for all of us to be as consistent in this, and as often as possible, whenever possible, we want it to be as consistent as possible. And so this is the idea of the cycle consistency. And I'm going to explain it mathematically in a second, but I wanted to give you the high level. And so if you have two videos for every frame, I'm looking at in the other one, which frames is the closest to me. And then I can look for that frame that's closest to me, which other frame from my neighbors, did they prefer me or not? And that's kind of the idea. So mathematically, what it looks like is, for now, maybe they share an encoder. I talk about it as two different encoder, but let's, for now, in a multimodal case, which I don't think I've seen yet, but you could imagine an extension of this work to have a multimodal case. But for now, the unimodal case, you could imagine is the same modality, so encoders are going to be the same. And so each frame will have a representation like 3,000 dimension vectors. And then I will start a multiple step process. The first one is for a specific frame. There, in this image, I do it the other way. For a specific frame, I will look at all of the frame in the other sequence or maybe within a window. And then I will see which one is the closest to me, like some kind of similarity between the two. And then that will give me my soft nearest neighbor. And the soft nearest neighbor, what I will do for that soft nearest, and it could be a hard nearest neighbor. It just empirically works. The hard nearest neighbor will say, hey, this person is my nearest neighbor. The soft one is a typical like kind of attention base. It's just like saying from all of them, what is it that looks like me? And so there may be many frames that looks like me here. And so if there are many frames that looks like me, I'm just going to take an average of all these frames that looks like me. And then what you take is that average frame that looks like me, if it's a soft. If it was a hard, it would be just that frame that looks the closest to me. I take that frame, and then I will look all my neighbors, how similar they are to that soft neighbor, like how close are they. And as you can imagine, what you would hope is that it is as close as possible to me, but in reality, it may look slightly closer to other frame. And if it is, I'm going to penalize it. And so now this is going to be part of my loss, is because I'm well penalized at distance I, sorry, it's really hard to see probably on the Zoom, but this is I. So I will penalize the distance between the two, normalize by some kind of, depending on how well, like if it's a very peaky thing, like if it's a peaky distribution, that's very different from if it's a flat distribution. And so that's what this is gonna add to it. So the mean of that Gaussian this is just for normalization. And I may have just, because I want to have maybe more peaky or like I want to put some regularization on from that. So this is the temporal cycle consistency. It's a nice and intuitive. What was really nice, and I invite you to read the paper. I don't think we put it as a reading assignment, but it's a nice optional one we could add to put there if it's not, I forgot if we put it already or not in the reading assignment. But yeah, this is nice because not only can you do the alignment, you also learn an embedding, and it turned out that you can later on use this embedding with only one video and may be able to do good action recognition, for example. But here in our case, the penalty will be done with that term. So they can do that also and see which frame looked the most like me. And so take a video and run it with the temporal cycle consistency and then see which frame is the nearest neighbor. And then what's really nice is that they should semantically be similar. And so that's the hope, is that my embedding that I learned is even more. Previous embeddings, if you remember, most of the embeddings before were for object detection. Like, is it a glass or not? Here, it's not just a glass, but it's about the appearance of the glass. And that's the interesting aspect here, is that it gives more guidance in the visual embedding, so that this extra guidance hopefully will make an encoder that's a little bit closer to a more meaningful or semantically meaningful embedding. And then the interesting part was, like, if you have something you expect, like a video of the way you should be doing something, if there are frames that are just not similar to any of the other frames, you could call it an anomaly. And I would like to call more as a research question for you. How could you extend this idea to multimodal? And what will be the challenge here? And so I want to keep it open ended, that question. I give you some hints of the answer. Definitely the encoders will be different. Like if you have, you'll have a different, like, let's say, for images or for language, we'll have different encoders. But the important thing is also the similarity. So how similar my closest neighbor will also be challenging. And that's maybe why you will need to do some of the approaches. Maybe you do a joint embedding where everything is together, or if you decide to have them more as coordinated, then the similarity function would be very important. How do you find that the two are similar? I think that's very interesting. I want to now switch to the second half of the lecture today and talk about the concept of multimodal translation. This is the idea of the typical image, the translation, multimodal translation has been image captioning. As I mentioned in one of the first lecture, one of the challenges with image captioning was that it was very hard to evaluate. You could have many different captions, but then at the same image, maybe people decide to focus, yes, on maybe the most salient object, but you could also suddenly decide to talk about other object, and both are in a sense valid. And so the interesting extension of this, which was proposed, is the visual question answering. The visual question answering goes with the idea that you have a question, is the skateboard airborne? You have an image, and then you have an answer. And different version of VQAs, and then you have, for example, now extensions like text VQA. I think some of the teams are working on this. Like there have been a lot of extension of VQA to make these either longer or a different flavor. But in the original one, the answers were relatively short. So short that, in fact, and some of them were repetitive so that they were able to even like get a vector of the 1,000 most occurring answers. And so they were even able to bring it as not even just a text generation, but as a classification problem. And so from an evaluation perspective, if it is a 1,000 labels and we're having some prediction over those, we know how to evaluate that part. And so that brought interesting, at least it improved on the evaluation part. Now it's a translation, but it's interesting because it's almost a two-way translation and or three ways, if you say. One is, you could say, I'm translating from language and then to image to eventually to an answer. I'm looking at the image first, I'm looking at the question and then at the answer. So what is the flow a human will do and what is the flow a computer should do, I think is quite an interesting. So if you had to put attention in this case, like use some of the concept, because we probably want, it's a translation, but it's also an alignment problem because I want to align some elements of the image with some of the element of the question. And so how to do this and how can we use maybe attention? The typical way you probably, and that's the way I introduce attention in the earlier lecture, is to go from question to image. Like you have different words and you will try to ground or connect these images or objects. Let's say we have an RCNN that ran over the image. So you have a bunch of instances of objects, and then you have a instances of words, and then you want to match the two together. So we could attend, you could have, based on the language, you could maybe embed the language and try to see which object to focus on. Or you could also look the other way around and look at the image, maybe what's center, what's bigger, or a specific type of image. Maybe the people are more likely to talk about a human in the image. And then see what words are important in the question. And so which one to use? As you can imagine, someone nicely decided to do both. and that's called co-attention. And the idea here, and this is just a depiction of it, but the idea here is I can embed my question, but I have many entities in my questions. I can find a way to embed and get a context and then use that to you embed my question, find my attentions, and then find a way to embed it. And the vice versa also for this. So you can get the co-attention going back and forth. So the question can be embedded and the image can be embedded at the same time. And then you get the visual embedding that's contextualized. And as you can see, now these days, how would you do that co-attention? It will probably also be with a self-attention, but that's kind of a precursor of this idea of self-attention. The co-attention paper had come also with the idea of looking at it at different level. Like one is a unigram, which is one aspect. One is about the bigram, and one is about the whole sentence. So the question is like, maybe you want to attend specific part of the image based on the whole sentence, or you would like to do the more classic attention based on each word where in the image. And at the end of the day, maybe you want to do all of them. So this paper did both like hierarchically and co-attention as well. I just want to share another extension that had been done and produced, which was the stack attention. So the idea is that, and as we've seen this also in the multi-headed attention, we can stack these different attention. And so the attention of one can be used to the next one, to the next level. And there's a lot of things, and I want to present that, and that's not the main focus of this lecture. I just wanted to give a few more, just because these days we always often go to self-attention model and transformers, but I would like people to be aware of other work before that, both as a precursor of where we come from when we talk about self-attention, but also to think about other ideas you could extend beyond just, and sometimes also your model, maybe just if you go with the self-attention, so many parameters, and maybe for that kind of data, there's no easy way to pre-train. And so there's another reason you should look at those simpler attention models. I often start with simple models, more interpretive. It's easier to interpret. I think there's a lot of value there. But the main thing I wanted to talk about and why I introduced the VQA was to talk about another aspect, which is an extension of the attention models. Also what I like the most about the next part is the idea of bringing domain knowledge. I know something about this domain, and instead of training everything from scratch, from bottom up and like very data driven, let me use some knowledge I have about the problem and add this. And maybe one of this knowledge is about the syntax of the language, or it could be others, and I'm going to show other ways you can do that. So the approach, and which it has been quite a bit of extension about, is neural module network. And neural module network allows to bring knowledge, two types of knowledge. One is about sentences, like sentence or linguistic knowledge is the question or the caption or the question can be splitted And instead of using a simple RNN to answer this question or embed this question, there may be some knowledge I can get from how this sentence, this question is syntax and its structure. And we've seen that consistency parsing and dependency parsing. For now, we'll look at dependency parsing, but we could use either of them. And what we will do with this knowledge is that instead of trying to solve the problem of visual question answering by just embedding the question directly, we'll go step by step. And so let me show it here. Is the bus full of passenger? Full of passenger. The subject here, you could say the verb is the root, the subject is the bus, the determinant, and then you have is full, so together, and then we have the passengers. And so we have a nice, here in this case, a dependency parsing of this. And when you have this, it kind of gives you some nice way to address this question. And the idea here is, what are the main two pieces, like the leaves? We talk about passenger and we talk about buses. So why don't I start and look at buses, and I look at passengers or people, and can I find these? And then maybe I can combine the two together, and then I can see if they match the concept of full. And so that's what's called in the world of neural module network, a computation layout. And what's nice now is that instead of very fully data-driven, where you hope that your RNN or transformer will contextualize things correctly, here we're going with the knowledge from syntax and language structure by saying, what are the noun phrases? Well, find my noun phrases in my sentence. Let's find them in the image. Let's just attend to them and find an embedding. And then if, for example, I want to bring these concepts together, and then I want to know if in fact the measure will be the full. Is these bus and full, are they combining together? Are they the two together? So this is an example of a computation layout. I talk about the using also, this is a computational layout we're using dependency parsing. I also hinted about using consistency parsing. In that case, it will be looking at noun phrases and it will be looking at verb phrases. In the case of the original neural module, in this case, they use a different approach, and there they look more for the dependency parsing. So you, in this case, look at the concept of full, the concept of bus, and here the bus is easy, the full will be hard, and then you bring the two together, and bus is full. You can, what's nice with the module network, it's less like the specific of these modules, but now I can, and I'm gonna learn end-to-end to fine-tune each of these modules and also the full task together. The full task is to answer like visual question answering, but the subtask is to have to also train each of these modules to perform as well as possible. And in the original module network, they predefined these. And that's why I kind of like the concept here is that that the neural module network is that I can take external knowledge and put it in it. And how do they do this? Is like they look at the parsing and then they define those modules themselves. It is a little bit arbitrary. That's their decision. It could have been done differently, but they decided to define a subset of module. And I don't want you to get overhang on like these exact module. I think these are fair. These are good module, but there's a lot of other module you could have probably done, but these are a good starting point. They decided, hey, I will have one module to attend on object. Give me any concept and I'm gonna tell you where in the image it is. And then I will just have a module about combining different concepts. So if I don't know, I have a green and a house. And so I could have everything that's green and everything that's a house. And then I bring the two combined together. And so I have a greenhouse together. So that's the concept of combining. But then I also have a task in mind. And so, what is interesting is that I have a task in mind and the task, I'm gonna condition on language. And that's interesting here, is that instead of having a task of like, is it that location? Or is that object present? Or is the glass full? Or like you could think of all of these. Instead of that, they're like, hey, give me a verb. Or give me something, like give me a word. And I'm gonna use this word to, with the image and to up to now what you identified, to finally decide on the final solution, like the final answer. And so they define a kind of a classifier condition on the word. And that's I thought was quite interesting. And finally, they said there may be different ways of doing prediction. In some cases, it may be that that I want to condition, or maybe I just want to go directly on all of the object and just find it, is it there or not? Like maybe some questions are so obvious that I can just go and just look at the attention map and to find, is it there or not? So this is the interesting aspect. So the take home, and I'm going to talk about extension on how to optimize and everything automatically and the computation grab. But the intuition here is that you have a problem that's relatively complex. And instead of like putting everything maybe on one giant, let's say, transformer and just hope that everything works, I'm saying, hey, can I split it in pieces? And instead of having all of these pieces the exact same unit, like we have in a tree LSTM, here we'll have dedicated modules. And these module will have different aspect to it. So they will have more module, and then I can use my knowledge to define what those module could be. And then I will need a kind of a deterministic way of taking any kind of input, like a question or a statement, and create a computational graph. So I have, as input, I have a sentence, and I have a possible set of module that's kind of predefined. And then I'm gonna create, for that specific input, I'm gonna create a computational graph. And right now, this is the kind of deterministic base on the parsing tree. I'm gonna tell you about it in a second on how to make it so that the computational graph is also learn how to create a computational graph live as well. So one of the interesting thing here is that when this, right before this neural module network came out, there was this really cool data set that had been suggested, which is called the Clever. And for many of us, we were like, oh, it brings some very complex question. And so for these very complex questions, we want to be sure how we're going to solve those very complex questions. And it sounded like it will take us a year or two to solve that. Not a year or two, but many years. But it turned out the neural module network was just perfectly designed for this kind of data set. Because although the questions are very complex, they had been created by a computer, or some of them at least were created by a computer. So if you create those questions, they look complex for a human, but if you can slice them well, they can be really nicely created. But I said one of the challenge with the original neural module was that how do you go from my input to a computational graph? And one thing that I liked about this was to let's use an RNN why did they use an RNN? This was at that point the kind of sequence modeling you could use, probably need these days a transformer or something else to do this. But what was interesting is that they used an RNN to decide what to do next. So you have a bunch of module, and let's say for now they're predefined module, but to decide which module to do, instead of making it as a graph and run through the graph, what I will do is make it as a sequence. And I make it as a sequence of modules. And then each of this will also be connected together, but it has a flavor in a little bit in a stack network, kind of stack LSTM. But yeah, the RNN is gonna be able to predict which module to use. And then I have a sequence of it. And then once I get that sequence of it, then I can get finally my answer. So this is a nice way of taking it in an end-to-end manner. So for many of your projects, as you look at this, try to think of like maybe some of those more interpretable approach, interpretable, and also one where you could put more knowledge, because this is a really small set of modules, but for each of your problem, you could probably imagine having other kind of module. And so that would be something to think about. One thing I want to show is an extension of neural module network, which goes beyond that to try to make it even more interpretable. And like any good paper come with a good title, neural symbolic network. Neural symbolic network is an extension of the neural module network, but it comes both at a price but it also comes with great advantages. The price is that we're gonna take some very complex representation of both vision and acoustic, and we will make it discrete or very interpretable or very simple. We're gonna simplify, like instead of having 7,000 dimension, I'm gonna force it to be simpler. And we could call it like kind of attributes of an image or a language. So I simplify, but by simplifying my representation, both visual and maybe also you could do the same for language, but specifically for visual, it comes at a great advantage that I will improve my interpretability. So in typical approach, I will get my R-mask, R-CNN, but in a typical approach is that for each of these R-CNN, I will have like maybe a vector of 3,000 for each of them. Here, what they do is I will train on another data set. I'm going to pre-train on another data set. In fact, I may not even fine-tune it. I think in the original paper, it was maybe not even fine-tuned. I'm going to train on another set to be able to predict different attributes of the objects, like small versus large, or cube versus cylinder, or the type of metal, or maybe the position. Well, the position I can get directly from RCNN. And so I go from a vector of maybe 3,000 to some very concrete attributes. So this is human interpretable attributes. And so that's a good advantage. So that will be my here. And then for the question, what I will do is a lot more like the neural module network, is I will take my question. And I will, in this case, they had the the extension of the original neural module network, where the computation graph is defined based on the encoder. And then from this, I get a sequence of kind of a program instead of, you could, it's a computation graph, but it's a sequence computation graph. So you could call it a program. And then instead of running the program on the CNN, I'm going to run it on this. So these program will be, instead of taking as input maybe the object, the RCNN output, they will take these. And so the first step is similar. And so you execute these. And if you really, really wanted, like, very simple, you could make these whatever you want. I mean, if you want them, very interpretable, we could make them rule-based systems here. So filter shape, maybe a rule-based or decision tree, you could make them as, so now if you make this very interpretable and my input is interpretable, my question was parsed in something that is interpretable, I get something quite interpretable as at the end, because then I can take any of these program and apply it on my interpretable input, get a new interpretable output, and then I can get finally my answers. And hopefully I can solve through that some things like counting, which has been a challenge for many for a long time in these for a long time, meaning a year or two. Yes. And so this is just an example output from the original paper, where the neural symbolic VQA, where the nice thing here is that the neural symbolic programs more accurate answers, but also it's interesting to see the kind of program that has been run to this. And so by being symbolic, as long as I got an attribute that is related to the question, and this kind of world is like all of the question in that world were kind of identifiable, and there was nice way of creating attribute. The challenge is, how do you scale this to a world that where maybe the dictionaries is not as easy to do, but that I leave it to you guys to in your project maybe to explore that. An extension for neural symbolic was to learn visual concept, word, and semantic of sentence without explicit supervision of any of them, just by looking at images and reading pair question. So that was a nice extension. So this is a little bit more in the world of self-supervised. I just give you a question and answers, and I give you this, but I don't give you what those specialized modules should be. And I want you to learn them. I don't tell you yet what the concept should be. And then I want you to learn that automatically. And that I thought was a nice aspect of that line of research into this. Another extension that is just explaining one way to do this. And some aspect of it was with reinforcement learning. So I'm pointing to that. We'll discuss more reinforcement learning in 2 weeks. I think it's a really, the basic aspect of it is that I suddenly, the concept in itself, there's a small chance that those representation are not as human interpretable. That's still possible, but hopefully they are. And so a concept, you will hope that those concepts are human interpretable, but there's, I mean, unless you do the previous approach, it's still an open problem to improve this. And I want to share, this is just another example where the concept, but the problem is, how do you name those concepts afterward? And then what's nicely is, like, you go and look at this, and then you can find which objects are selected, and then you can give it, and that goes the same when we were doing topic modeling for language as well. Okay, the last part, I just wanted a few slides on this. It's more like for entertainment at the end for the last 2 minutes. I thought it was interesting because we talk about translation, but sometimes it's good to go a little bit beyond what everybody else is doing. There's one paper I wanted to bring, which was really interesting, which was take an object and hit it. And for now, let's say I hit it always with the same wood. So it will be quite different from, I'm not gonna hit my cell phone too much, but the sound is different. And so the idea was, like, can I detect object just by how they sound? That was really interesting to me. And so that was one, sound of pixel. Was a really interesting extension. Sorry for the whole graph, but what I wanted to show here is that you get a lot of video, and there's a lot of video with audio, and what I would like to do is, I don't tell you where the sound come from, but because you see so many videos of people talking, you will realize that there is a correlation with lips moving and some sound, or maybe with violin or some instrument. So I don't tell you that a voice always comes from the mouth, that that the guitar comes from a specific visual, but you can do all of this automatically. And so you learn just from video on YouTube, unannotated videos. It's paired data, so you have audio and video paired, and then you can learn what's called the sound of pixel. And they've been, what's really interesting is, I just put one of them, but there's about 5 papers in less than 6 months that all did the same thing in slightly different way. That's also a sound. And the last one was speech to face, and that comes with a lot of downside, and that's why we have this lecture in a few more weeks at the end of this about bias and issues with this. But yeah, speech to face, the idea is, given a voice, can I estimate the age, gender, or maybe ethnicity of someone? And so you get the voice encoder, you encode maybe the face, and then decode the face. That's for training, and at test time, you can just from the voice decode the face. So these are some applications. I also wanted to make you think about your research. This is not the only topic, but thinking about fairness and this when you look at your research is something important. And so I want you to also think about these issues. Thank you very much for your attention.